Good morning. I'd like to welcome you to worship here at York Minster Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are here today with us, whether worshiping in person or with us online. My name is Dowler Wheat, and I have the privilege to serve as your Director of Family Ministry. Pastor Laura is out enjoying some vacation time, so we will be observing communion next Sunday, April 14th. I want to welcome any visitors, especially today, and let you know there are connect cards in the pews. They are an opportunity for the level at which you feel comfortable. You can share your information with us, and you can hand that to an usher or drop it in one of the two offering boxes on either side of the double doors in the narthex on your way out. If you are joining us online, you will also have an opportunity to connect with us, and you will see that electronically on your screen. Following worship, we will have coffee in the Commons. That is the building directly to your right when you exit here, and we would love the chance to have a chat and to get to know you. Our offering this morning will be taken through the offering boxes that I just mentioned out in the narthex as you exit. We believe it is a response to hearing God's word, so you may take advantage of all of the options we offer, such as your bank's bill pay function, electronically through our website, or mailing it into the church office. Our special cause for April is One Great Hour of Sharing. For 75 years, this has provided Presbyterians a way to share God's love with our neighbors in need around the world through programs like Presbyterian Disaster Assistance, the Presbyterian Hunger Program, and Self-Development of People. They all work in different ways to serve individuals and communities in need. From initial disaster response to ongoing community development, their work fits together to provide people with safety, sustenance, and hope. You can make a donation online or mail it into the church office. We are very excited to remind everyone of wonderful changes happening in the life of this church. Beginning May 5th, you have a whole month, we will begin a new Sunday schedule with adult Sunday school starting at 9 o'clock, followed by worship here in the sanctuary at 10:30, with pre-K through fifth grade Sunday school happening during the worship service. Nursery will be offered during both Sunday school and worship. A letter went out from Pastor Laura and the session through our electronic newsletter, as well as hard copies being mailed home 2 weeks ago. Pastor Laura and the session invite anyone needing clarification or if they have questions to a coffee and questions session following worship next Sunday, April 14th. That would be over in Covenant Hall. Following the start of this new schedule on May 5th, we invite you to a wonderful fellowship lunch with the church providing the main dish at the wonderful and capable hands of Ted Geik. And everyone will please bring a side if your last name starts A through L. And no, everyone cannot just bring potato salad. Or dessert if your last name starts M through Z. We are very excited about this, and I, for one, am really looking forward to May 5th. Choir and bells resume this week, and everyone is welcome. If you have any questions about that, if you have a friend, if you're eager to participate, please see our director of worship, Paula. Paula, can you raise your hand? That's Paula. Just see her, and she can give you all of that information. This week, there are no family ministry programs. Youth group will resume next Sunday, April 14th, with a game night and a cereal bar at 5:30. And Wild Wednesdays and Chimes returns at their normal times beginning Wednesday, April 17th. Vacation Bible School is coming up. Please save the date. This year's theme is Scuba Diving into Friendship with God. It will be July 29th through August 2nd from 9 o'clock in the morning to 12:30. Registration will be coming soon, as well as many, many opportunities to volunteer beginning in May through the end of VBS. So I look forward to sharing those with you. Let us prepare our hearts and our minds to worship God. please stand if you are able and join me in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin. Come, sisters and brothers, gather together. From all the bruises of a busy week, gather. Plunge your sorrow and worry into the fountain of life. Here, find comfort and hope. Place your dreams and concerns on the table of blessing. Here, find courage and renewal. Give your questions and doubts to the heart of God. Here, find a peace that lightens the load and restores the faith. Come, all of you, to this place. Become a family of love, a community of song, a people of prayer. Please join in singing our first hymn, number 478, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
Remember that our Lord can sympathize with us in our weaknesses, since in every respect he was tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with boldness approach the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Let us pray. Redeeming God, you bring life out of dead ends and hope in the midst of despair. Forgive us for doubting that you are still at work, even in the darkest hour, even in the most painful moments. Forgive us for our hesitant action, our conscious compassion, our too frequent reluctance. Redeeming God, teach us a stillness that leads to faithful witness and bold compassion. Form us in your love that loosens our worry and eases our anger. Make us disciples filled with love, acting with justice, and living out hope. Amen. Let us now continue in prayer in the silence of our hearts. who doth freely pardon all who repent and turn to him, now fulfill in every contrite heart the promise of redeeming grace, remitting all our sins and cleansing us from an evil conscience, through the perfect sacrifice of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Come up here. Come on, little Bitsy Witsy. All right. Okay. Today, we have a special person in the pulpit. We have Mr. Whitehead, and he is going to talk to us today about miracles. What is a miracle?
A miracle is something that seems impossible, but it happens, and it's very extraordinary.
Excellent. Professor, you have a different...
No?
Okay, yes, it is. It's when God uses his powers to cause something to happen on the earth. Now, can you think of some miracles in our lives? Professor?
Jesus dying on the cross for our sins.
Absolutely. That was the biggest miracle in the world, Jesus dying on the cross. Can you think of any other ones?
Our family, that's a miracle.
Yes, our families are miracles. What about the birth of a baby? That's a miracle. That's a miracle. What about the sun rising?
That happens every day, but yeah.
It does happen every day, but yeah, it is a miracle. What about when we plant a seed in the ground? What do you think?
Yeah. It grows and it's a miracle. It grows and it's a miracle when it grows.
Absolutely. So we see miracles every single day. But when Jesus was on the earth, he performed many, many miracles. I bet you, can you all name any of them that he did?
He rose somebody back from the dead. He rose himself back from the dead. He healed the blind. He made a man that couldn't walk, walk. He did like 1,000. He turned water into wine.
Yes, and there you have it. That's a synopsis of what Jesus did on earth. That's exactly right. But he never used those miracles to show off, to go, look at me, I'm better than everybody else, and I can do this. Do you know anybody else that can raise somebody from the dead?
Nope.
No, I don't either. Yes, God did. So, he did raise a widow's son from the dead, and he turned water into wine. And I think we're going to hear a scripture today about how he fed 5,000 people with
two little fish and one loaf of bread, I think.
Well, I think it was 7 loaves of bread and a few little fish. He fed 5,000 people. Now, the very first miracle he performed was turning water into wine. And then the last miracle he performed. Does anybody know what that was? I didn't know it.
No, going up to heaven.
No. Now, that he performed, that he did. I didn't know this one either. When, yeah, okay. When he was with the high priest's servant, the night before he died. Simon Peter cut off the high priest's servant's ear, and Jesus put it back on, or did it back. That was the last miracle he performed. Now, Jesus is good and he's powerful. He has the power to heal and he has the power to give life to the dead. But Jesus is God, and when we hear about his miracles, we want you to be encouraged to go to him for help. Don't be afraid to say, well, I just don't feel right. I'm sad today. Instead of going back and going to God and say, God, will you help me not be sad today? Can we do that?
Yeah.
So, yes, we can. And even though, you two are a mess. Even though Jesus cares about us, he's more powerful than any superhero you've ever read about. Anyone, he's more powerful. He can turn water into wine, calm a stormy sea, give sight to the blind. But when Jesus is with us, God is with us, okay? All right, so when Mr. Whitehead talks about it today, you're going to know what he's talking about, okay? Let us have a pray after me prayer. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for performing miracles. And thank you for caring about everyone. Amen. Okay. Hey, you want to do me a favor? Go over and put this on that bench where I got it. Go put the mic away right there on that first bench. Okay, come on.
Thank you, Vicki. Our first lesson this morning comes from the book of Mark, chapter 8, verses 1 through 8, and it appears on page 37 in your pew Bible. You're welcome to turn to it and read along with me. In those days, when there was again a great crowd without anything to eat, he called his disciples and said to them, I have compassion for the crowd, because they have been with me now for 3 days and have nothing to eat. If I send them away hungry to their homes, they will faint on the way, and some of them have come from a great distance. His disciples replied, How can one feed these people with bread here in the desert? He asked them, How many loaves do you have? They said, Seven. Then he ordered the crowd to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves, and after giving thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to distribute. And they distributed them to the crowd. They had also a few small fish, and after blessing them, he ordered that these too should be distributed. They ate and were filled, and they took up the broken pieces left over, 7 baskets full. The word of the Lord. Thank you.
Good morning. Just as a reminder, we are Easter people, and it's still Easter. So our second reading is John 2, 1 to 11, the wedding at Cana. And if you want to follow along in your pew Bibles, it's on page 80 of the New Testament. Listen then for the word. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were 6 stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The word of God. So Jesus' first miracle, and at the end of the passage, John tells us that after the miracle, his disciples believed in him. So we know that this was an important start to his ministry and with the relationship to his disciples. But it doesn't match the gravity of the miracles that follow. Water to wine? What kind of a miracle is that? Well, I know it's a miracle, but the scale of the miracle. And why this particular miracle? It's John, so we know that there's a lot going on here. The other Gospels mostly tell us what happened. John is writing his Gospel a lot later, and John is all about telling us why it happened. So you see in verse 6, he tells us about these stone jars that were used for purification. Okay, purification, wine. What does wine represent in communion? Blood, which atonement. So you see, John makes a lot of connections as he goes through his gospel, but I don't think that's exactly the case going on here, or I want to pursue something a little different as to the motivation of this miracle. Now, Mary seemed to be involved in the wedding, and scholars tell us that the wedding was probably for someone in Mary's family, or maybe Joseph's family, and that the bride and groom were probably cousins of Jesus. So whatever the case, Mary had a vested interest in this wedding. And at the time, the culture of that time, honor culture, hospitality culture, running out of wine at a wedding would have been very bad. It would not have reflected well on the family. So Mary, knowing this, goes to find Jesus. And she tells him, pretty bluntly, "We have no wine." Jesus' response is interesting. He says, "Why is this our problem? It's not my time. So what do you want me to do about it? I'm not prepared to start my ministry." Mary's response, she turns to the servants and says, "Do whatever he tells you." So she just completely ignores Jesus' response and basically says, "Do it." Do whatever he tells you, with the expectation that something's going to happen. So she is completely convinced that Jesus obviously is going to solve the problem. Now, we know that Jesus was fully human and fully divine. Okay, the fully human part shows that he's not immune to the power of mothers. Now, I'm not saying that Mary was demanding a miracle, but she trusted that Jesus was going to solve the problem. I mean, after all, he had this group of disciples. He could have gone out and looked for wine to bring it back. But Jesus does solve the problem with the miracle. Why? Well, John says, as a sign for his disciples. But I think it was something else. And I think it was primarily because Jesus had compassion for the bride and groom. He was averting the shame that would have followed the couple and their family at that time and in that community, probably for years afterwards. They would have been known as the people that ran out of wine. They were too cheap to buy enough wine for a good party. Okay, or they didn't care enough about the hospitality, this concept of hospitality, to put on a decent wedding. It would have been gossiped about in Cana for years. So the bridegroom, Gary and Kathy, walking down the street, and the people in the background are going, well, bless their hearts, there's that couple that ran out of wine at the wedding. Not good. Jesus knew this, so he had compassion for them. And we see this over and over in the gospel. In the passage that we just read, the first passage, we get the quote from Jesus. The crowd had been following him. They were out in the middle of nowhere with nothing to eat. They had been there for 3 days. And the disciples, Jesus is done speaking to them. He's ready to move on. And he tells the disciples, the disciples are ready to tell the crowd to go away. But Jesus says, I have compassion for the crowd. Direct quote from Jesus. I have compassion for the crowd. They have been with me for 3 days with nothing to eat. So we get the miracle of feeding of the multitude because he had compassion. Now, running out of wine isn't on the same level as miraculous healings or feeding of multitudes, but it shows that God is concerned with our lives, with what matters for us, even in mundane things. Now, I want to focus not so much on the miracles that we've been talking about here, but on the motivation and that common thread of compassion. So hold that thought, because I'm going to shift from opening the scriptures to you to some personal testimony. And I want to testify to something that happened to me, and then I'll pull this all together to show it how it relates to all of us. We live on Sayers Creek in Gloucester. And one Memorial Day, not long after we'd moved over there, I had taken my boat off the lift because my son was going to come over with my granddaughters for a fun day on the water. Well, unfortunately, Memorial Day turned out to be an unseasonably cold and wet day. So we canceled the outing with the family. So I decided to go down and put the boat back on the lift rather than move it or leave it out in the rain over the weekend. So as I was maneuvering the boat onto the lift, pulling it up on the cradle with the dock line, it bumped the cradle, so I missed getting up on the cradle initially, and the wet line pulled out of my hands, and the boat starts to move away. Wonderful. So I have nothing to capture the boat with, so I figure if I can reach out and grab the boat before it gets too far away, I won't have to dive into the cold water to retrieve the line and put the boat back up on the dock. So the boat's pulling back. I think I can do this. And I reach out for the boat, and my fingers just brush the railing of the boat, and I overbalance and right into the water. I bounce off the cradle, lift cradle, and fall backwards into the water. And I popped back up out of the water, thinking this could have been really bad if my head had hit that cradle, because I felt it was probably about 4 feet. And as it was, afterwards I had a nasty bruise across my chest and sore ribs for about a week after that. But since I was in the water, I grabbed the line, I got the boat, put it back up on the lift, and then I initiated a stealth entry into my home. Now I say stealth entry because I was embarrassed about falling off the dock again. I know you're shocked at that, right? In a previous dip, my oldest son had told me, "Dad, you're getting too old to be down on the dock by yourself. Whenever you need that boat put back up on the lift, you call me and I'll come and do it for you." Right. And he said that without any inclination what the impact might have had on his inheritance. He has a history of overpromising and underperforming, so I knew that wasn't going to happen. Okay. And, well, my granddaughter is the only reason he's still in the will. In my defense, the previous times that I had fallen into the water off the dock, I had been carrying heavy things, like, and bulky things like our kayaks. And one of the times that I fell into the water, I was carrying a heavy ice chest down to the dock, and I was escorted by my dog, Macy. Now, Macy loved to come down on the dock with me. But Macy's special talent was getting underfoot. And she did so, and I went in the water again. So after that dip, my wife essentially told me that I should be supervised anytime I go down on the dock. And I really wanted to avoid any lectures and any teasing about me being waterborne. So I successfully infiltrate to the house. Dry clothes, and all is well. I am undetected, good to go. Until that evening, when I start looking for my glasses. Okay, now I have astigmatism, so I don't wear my glasses much when I'm home because it's primarily it helps me see at a distance, or when I'm reading. If I read a lot, my eyes get tired, I'll wear my glasses. So typically I don't have my glasses on. So I look everywhere for my glasses in the house, and I'm just getting frantic because at that time, the glasses were brand new. I had just picked them up the day before. Okay, so I can't find them. I'm frantic, and I finally just stop. Let's think about what happened. What was I doing before I went down on the dock? I was reading. And I went out to do a weather check, and I hadn't intended initially to put the boat back up on the dock, but because it was raining, I decided to go back, put the boat on the dock, up on the lift, and since I was reading, I had my glasses on, and they're probably in the creek. So the realization hits me. Now, A, I have to go and tell Kathy that I've fallen off the dock again, and B, I was wearing my brand new glasses and they're in the creek. Yeah, so I'm gonna have to go and buy a new pair of glasses. That wasn't a conversation that I wanted to have. I wasn't concerned about Kathy being upset about me losing the glasses. Okay, maybe a little bit. I was embarrassed about falling off of the dock and losing my glasses. So once again, I could see having to tell her every time I was going down on the dock to do anything, and having her stand at the top of the stairs of the dock with the life preservers watching me. So the more I thought about it, the more determined I became that I would have to make at least some effort to try and find those glasses. So the planning starts. Didn't get a lot of sleep that night because my mind was racing, trying to come out how I'm going to recover these glasses. And how impossible it seemed. So I'm up at first light, and I can't adequately tell you how much I was spun up. I mean, I screwed myself right into the ceiling over this one. So I sneak out to the garage to gear up, and there's still a cold, misty rain going on, so I put on my waders. And for people that you don't know, waders are basically, if you think of waterproof bib overalls, with a big pair of boots attached at the bottom. And then I put on a rain jacket in civilian. And I start, now I realize that I haven't done all of the planning because how am I gonna recover the glasses? What am I gonna scoop the bottom for? You know, and my first thought, colander probably wouldn't have worked. So I look around my garage, and the only thing I could come up with Isn't that going to cover a lot of ground? Kind of speaks to my state of mind at the time. So I take my trusty crab net, and off to the dock I go. And I plop down in the water, and my dock has two wings on it with the lift in the middle. So I move over to the right wing, closest to the point where I fell off, and I go into the water, and the water is waist deep, and it's cold, and it's raining. And I wedge myself up against the lift and the dock on this side. I square myself up, and I start scooping. And I start with my left foot, and I work all the way across and up under the lift on the other side. And all I'm getting is sand and mussel shells. Well, after I finish that first scoop, I reconsider my options. This looks to be impossible. It's just not going to happen. But I determined to make one complete sweep all the way across the dock, and that space is about from the edge of the pulpit here to the end of the communion table. And I'm going to make one sweep so I can honestly tell Kathy that I made a good faith attempt to recover my glasses. So I start to move, and my feet have sunk into the sand here a little bit, so I have to pull my foot loose. So I start to pull my left foot loose, and I feel a warmth on my right foot. It just keeps getting better and better. Now I have a leak in my boot. But then my brain kicks in. The water's cold, and I feel something warm on my foot, and I wiggle my toes, and my boot is not wet. That's bizarre. Well, so I decide to continue. Same process, I lean forward, start to lift the foot up out of the sand, and on my foot, I feel three taps. I freeze. What just happened? My first thought, crab. There's not a blue crab out there big enough. Remember, I said thick boots. That would have been a monstrous crab. For a second, just a second, I think, shark. I live on Sarah's Creek. It's salt water. We've had dolphins up the creek. It was possible, but my brain kicked in. Not a shark. What's going on here? And as I'm standing pondering in the rain, thinking about what I'm going to do, I hear this voice, thought, scoop your left foot by your left foot. What? That's where I started. I've already done that. And I get this urgent feeling that I need to scoop by my left foot. So I scoop by my left foot, and as I pull the net out of the water, in the net are my glasses. So I'm stunned. Stunned would be an understatement. And then, as I'm trying to take all of this in and process it, I hear that voice, thought again, that says, didn't you pray for this? Now I have to back up. As I was gearing up in the garage, I told you I was upset, and I did. I said, God, please help me find my glasses. But immediately after I did that, I dismissed that prayer, if you will. I remember thinking to myself, this is like asking God to help me find a parking spot at the mall. Thank you, Jesus, up front. So I just thought it was beneath God. This was my problem, and I needed to solve it. But the voice says, Didn't you pray for it? So God really heard that prayer? Or I know he heard the prayer. Even the way I presented it, let's say. And he chose to act on it. He chose to act on it. He didn't dismiss it. So I'm standing in the rain, and I'm pretty sure that it was the rain running down my face and not tears. But you know, experiencing that event the way I did, the tapping on my foot, not the boot, my foot, the thought and the voice telling me to scoop the place where I found my glasses were there, but I had already scooped that area. That was where I started. How did the glasses get there? And the final voice or thought saying, didn't you pray for this? You know, I was wound up, but I wasn't hallucinating. I wasn't at that point. I believe that God still does miracles today, and what I experienced was a miracle. But then came the hard part. Why me? Why this particular miracle? And what does it mean? When you think of miracles, you think of miraculous healings or people being rescued from near-death experiences. Why would the creator of the cosmos, the Lord God Almighty, send one of his angels to help Gary because a clumsy goof fell off the dock and lost his glasses? How was I supposed to respond to that? Was God pointing me at something? Is there something God wanted me to do? Gary, now that I have your attention, it's your call to enter the ministry. Gary, there's this mission trip I want you to handle. You know, how would you respond to something like that? Well, I was in a daze for about a week. My mind was spinning. I was praying on it. I wasn't sensing any discernment about what the Holy Spirit wanted me to do. So the brain finally kicked in again, and I sought out the counsel of a good friend, a wise and godly man, and he helped me wrestle with it. We discussed what happened, and then he helped me immensely by pointing me to a book by Eric Metaxas, titled appropriately enough, Miracles. Metaxas' book, it tells the stories of people who believe that they have experienced miracles. And there are some amazing experiences in there, to include one in particular that's very similar to my experience, minus the falling into the water part. Most importantly, Metaxas talks about why God does miracles. Between his insights and the other research that I had done while I was contemplating what happened, and a lot of prayer and soul searching, here's the condensed version of what I came to understand about miracles. If we believe that miracles can happen, then we have to think about why they happen and why they happen to some people at certain times and not others. The essential part of a miracle is God communicating with the people experiencing the miracle. One type of miracle then, and I believe the one that I experienced, is God communicating with us to let us know that he's real and that he cares about us. Because God made each of us individuals, he communicates with us individually. He's the same God for each of us, but in his love for us and in his desire to reach us, he speaks to us in ways that are very specific to us. But miracles aren't just communications. There's a particular intimacy to the miracles, as if God wants to let us know that he is with us, he sees what we're going through, and he cares. He cares. God's such a big God that he can keep the galaxy spinning and still deal with us on an intimate level, as his children. He has the time for each and every one of us and knows the details of our lives. He has, if it's important to us, it's important to God. We know that God is the Lord Almighty, but we are his children. Paul tells us as Christ followers, we are adopted into the royal family. As his children, we are privileged to call the God of creation Abba, Father. In the Gospels, God is called Father 179 times. Jesus tells us to pray to our Father. When God does miracles, he's communicating to us in a specific way to say, I'm here, in a way that gets our attention. Sure got my attention. Now, earlier on, I asked you to hold on to that discussion of Jesus responding with compassion and at times responding with unexpected miracles. Compassion. I believe that same compassion that so often motivated Jesus was why God responded to me and the way he did and with what he did. He knew how much I'd spun myself up and how distressed and angry at myself I was, and in that moment, how down on myself I was. My Father, my Abba, wanted me to experience just how much he loves me, that he is in fact real, and that one day I will know him as I am known by him. If God reached through time and space to give me a miracle when I needed to know in that moment that I wasn't just a clumsy oaf, I wasn't a complete idiot, and most of all, he wanted me to know that I was loved. What then does that say about God's love for everyone else? Jeremiah 31:3 says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. It seems to me that it says that God is more involved in our lives than we let ourselves believe. You may never get a miracle the way I did, but we can't dismiss the incidences and coincidences in our daily lives. Healings, needed money from out of nowhere, the help from strangers unexpected, kindness of others, just blessings that can't otherwise be explained if we just paused and thought about it. Some of those, at least, some of those incidences were probably God incidents. God is more near, more real, and more full of love, and more ready to help than we ever realize. So it's a mystery why God Almighty, the Creator and Lord of the hosts of heaven, reaches down to us on an individual level. We know that Jesus came to us in human form, in part to know us and to know intimately what it was like to be us. He was God reaching down to us to meet us on our level, to meet us where we are, and he still does. Miracles ultimately point to God himself. They point to a world beyond our world. They tell us that the other world is not in our imagination, but it's God's kingdom. And it says that heaven is real and it's out there. Now that's what I've come to believe from some pretty motivated study and contemplation. God does miracles for his own reasons, and that will always be part of the mystery of God. But I know with all my being and all of my soul, sometimes the reason he does miracles is just to show us how much he loves us. In Ephesians, Paul says, may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how deep, and how wide his love is. Amen? Amen. Amen. So stand as you're able, and we will join together in the affirmation of faith. The affirmation today is the Apostles' Creed, a creed that the church has followed for over 1,800 years. Let us say what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who suffered his was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead, and into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead.
believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the remission of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now I know why Pastor Laura keeps a water bottle up here. Please join me in prayer. Lord, we pray for people in countless countries caught up in war and conflict throughout the world. We pray for peace and reconciliation in the world. We pray for the Christians who are being persecuted for your sake, and we pray that you comfort and strengthen them in their faith. We pray for those who lead the governments of our cities, counties, state, and country. Give them the hearts and minds of servants for the well-being of all who live here. Help them to do what is right. We pray for members of our church family who need our blessings, for healing of those battling illness, and we pray for those who are facing financial hardships and those facing bereavement or personal loss. We pray for Yorkminster, that we gather in a loving community to carry out your will in service to each other and to our community, that we live the gospel in word and deed to further your kingdom. Lord, help us to remember that you're near us, more full of love, and more ready to help us than we realize. Help us to find comfort and joy in the sure knowledge that we are your children, adopted into the royal family. Father, you are faithful, and your love and care for us never fails. You will never forget us, never abandon us. You are our refuge in challenging times. Father, hear our prayers now as we pray in the way that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Comes freely to each of us, creating in us a sense of thanksgiving. God calls us to respond freely and joyfully with our time, our talent, and our finances. Here at Yorkminster, we have much to be thankful for each week. This week, let us be particularly thankful for our YPC PW circle leaders and Bible study leaders.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow.
God, of whose bounty we have all received, accept this offering of thy people and so follow it with thy blessing, that it may promote peace and goodwill among men and advance the kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Join me now in our final hymn, number 276, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face to you and grant you peace. So go now in the peace of God Almighty. Amen.